top stories this morning. Rockhampton's floodwaters haven't risen any higher. More rain is on the way, but it shouldn't add to the water levels there at the moment. And as St George prepares for record floods, the town has run out of sandbags.
An Australian man convicted of murder in Afghanistan has dodged the death sentence. Secret court documents have revealed he'll spend the next 20 years in jail instead.
And a new political era is taking shape in Washington. The new Republican-dominated Congress has just been sworn in, and the party's promising it won't be making life any easier for the president.
For a look at the national papers today, we're joined by Dr. Liam Lenton, a senior lecturer in sports economics at La Trobe University. Thanks very much for coming in.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mary. Good morning, Michael. Nice to be with you.
Yeah, and you've turned firstly to obviously the floods are the huge story, and to the Fin Review article in particular.
Yes, hard to miss this one, of course, Mary. But the Fin, interestingly enough, hasn't really given it much of a run until about page four. There's the small insert on page one, where predictably after a few days of toing and froing, Anna Bligh has turned her eyes towards Canberra asking for federal funds. And it's funny that on this occasion it seems to have taken a while for the discourse to turn to the role of governments in providing relief packages. This was a very, very different situation to what we saw with the bushfires 2 years ago, where the response was far more immediate. Obviously, very different situation. The nature of the disaster and the loss of life was far greater a couple of years ago. Nevertheless, it's interesting how different the coverage is this time around.
And the government, state and federal, are realising that it's going to be very much a long-term recovery effort in Queensland.
Definitely, as it is with any major disaster. But there's also been offshoots to that, also discussion on how it may affect the major reform packages that have been ongoing for a number of years.
And as you say, I mean, the first instance has been just about individual grants and those things. It's as if they're all just holding their breath to watch and see what happens to those roads and the rail and all the infrastructure. That will go on for years.
And yeah, and interestingly enough, it took a while also for the obligatory pictures to come out of Anna Bligh inspecting the damage. Again, the response seemed to be far more immediate 2 years ago.
And the Courier Mail, not surprisingly, has also run with the issue of not just the flood crisis, but who's going to pay for the clean-up.
Exactly. You can expect the Courier Mail to be running with this story on front page every day for at least another couple of weeks.
As they probably should. And, of course, though, we have another big campaign happening, which is the retailers.
Absolutely. And this has been a story that's only arisen in the last couple of days, but it seems that the campaign by the major retailers, we saw in yesterday's papers that the response was less than overwhelming by the consuming public. And perhaps the big retailers kind of misjudged the Australian public somewhat on this one. That's an understatement. But it turns out that what we see in today's papers is that the major retailers, and Gerry Harvey is the public face of this, they appear undeterred by this public criticism.
In fact, I think, and Michael read out earlier, the fierce Twitter campaign against him, and I think he said that my wife told me not to do this because he's taken so much on. They seem to be able to, wanting to ramp it up, almost fired up by this public response, as in the public doesn't get it.
Yes, but in the medium to longer term, the proof of the pudding will be in terms of changes and trends of sales between the major retailers and online alternatives, and it turns out that these trends continue, then you can expect these major retailers to buckle into that public pressure and perhaps change their business models, perhaps putting more of their resources into their own online competitors to those ones, and maybe changing the structure of their physical sites.
Well, that's right. I mean, and I read out a couple of the tweet posts earlier, and as looking down the list, there are some, how should I say, very expressive people out there with lots of stuff we can't read out on air, but a lot of people are also saying that, if anything, it's not only turned them onto online retail, but even heightened their interest in pursuing bargains and cheaper deals on the internet.
So that's a lesson as to the unintended consequences of lobbying.
And now they're continuing. It just seems like strange behaviour. Now, the Financial Review has a story about the Reserve Bank and a board seat coming up.
Two, as a matter of fact, Michael. Donald McGauchie's five-year term finishes in March, whereas the highly talented Warwick McKibben is vacating his spot in July. Now, as an economist, there are a few names around that I know. Warwick McKibben is one. time. So the front page of the Fin Review has taken a very different approach, but on page 5 of the Oz, the emphasis is on who's rumoured to take over that particular spot, and it seems like Ross Garnaut, who's kind of well known for his work on climate change, is widely tipped as one of the possibilities for one of those seats. Warwick McKibben also has done some work in that area. He's been on the board for 10 years, and there could be some changes in the wind. But the emphasis in the Fin Review is again quite different. They focus more on the selection process, and of course they bring up this this hint of political biases that have been made in past appointment decisions.
And how much should it mean to the general public? Obviously for economists, as you say, who know the names and who can glean what it might mean. Does it really mean that much for us? And can economists truly say that with the appointment of such and such versus such and such, that that will mean anything at all?
Well, it'll mean something insofar that economists who don't tend to agree about much on just about anything really will have differing opinions as to the merits of different candidates for those positions. But for the average Australian, who, while not all Australians have a mortgage, but a lot do and a lot are heavily indebted, I would say that they should be taking an interest at least in the composition of the RBA board, and that might even reflect through eventually to 50-50 decisions on whether to put up interest rates or not.
Now, we're running short of time. We might zip down to the last item on your list. And, Liam, I think you've shown remarkable self-restraint as a sports economist to choose only one sports story this morning, but it's a pretty good one.
Yeah, so it turns out, Michael, that Australia's been awarded hosting rights for the 2015 Asian Cup. For me, this is a no-brainer. Obviously, this comes at a time soon after we missed out on hosting rights for the 2022 World Cup. But, of course, there's a lot of bidding at the top end for the major events. Why I say that the Asian Cup was a no-brainer was there was very little competition for this event, and therefore...
Indeed, how many people were on the shortlist?
In fact, I think there was only one candidate who I forgot, and then they withdrew anyway. So it was clear that the AFC was going to give the hosting rights to Australia. Mm. But the point is, it's going to cost Australia very little. Obviously, the stadium infrastructure required for that scale of event is not going to be anywhere near the scale required that FIFA would demand for the World Cup. So that's why I said it was a no-brainer.
And how excited should we be about hosting it?
I think it should make us very excitable come 2015, because we are a new member of the Asian football community, and I'm sure that Les Murray and Craig Foster will have those sorts of views as well. But yeah, I think by the time it comes around, we'll get excited, as we tend to get excited about hosting any major event.
That's Asian Cup fever, I'm sure, will come. Thanks very much for coming in.
Thank you again, Mary. Thank you, Michael.
Thanks, Liam. Now to other sport headlines, and Amy Bainbridge. Everything, sadly, is going England's way at the SCG.
It certainly is, and it has done well all day on day 3 at least, and now England is eyeing a breakthrough series